Okay, so this is lecture 11. In lecture 10, we have discussed about 3D infinite potential well problem. And also, from this analytic solution of 3D infinite potential well, we have found the total number of electrons inside the 3D infinite potential well. You had exercise, no homework. I certainly sure that you have made a certain exercise by yourself. So let's go to today's lecture. Lecture 11. Deals with a similar system. However, instead of infinite potential well, which are confined along x direction and y direction and z direction, x, y, z, all three directions are just confined. However, in this case, we wanted to talk about just one-dimensional confinement. For example, only along z direction, and the motion along x direction and motion along y direction are allowed, freely allowed. In this case, we can expect that the solution of Schrödinger equation for this unbounded system will be just a plane wave. So we can easily understand the answer will be the plane wave along x direction and plane wave along y direction and confined solution for z direction. Product of these three different directional components will give us the total wave function. So we'll talk about it in this lecture. The major concept of today's lecture is subband. So subband simply means that this is a substructure, internal structure of a band. So what is band? So band is just to think about this one. We are always considering the EK relation. So momentum, crystal momentum of our electrons and its eigenenergy. That is our most concern. But when we introduce a slight change in the K, then of course we will have also slight deviation of energy. But we believe that if we change our K value only slightly, then energy will be changed only slightly. That is our usual assumption. And if that holds, then those points, so this point, then neighboring points are called, they are belonging in a band, because they can be regarded as just two of many points which are well connected. In a band, when we plot EK diagram, those two points are belonging on neighbor. However, for example, think about this one. Let's say this is zone boundary 3, and this is a general expression for our momentum space, and here we have the energy axis, and here you can see that this and this and this. Oh, so for example, Although they share the same k values, but we can have two different energy values. They are not easy to be considered as inner group. So they belong to different groups. Also, when you consider this point, then we can say these two points are belonging one group, but these two points are not belonging one group. So this is the situation usually when we consider the bulk, three-dimensional bulk, EK diagram. Up to now, I have talked about the situation where we distinguish different bands in bulk system. However, even when we have a system with further structural confinement, for example, let's say this x-directional dimension is quite large and y-directional dimension is quite large, but z-directional dimension is quite small. In this case, even when they are belonging to the bulk system, the bulk same band, for example, this one. Let me just repeat once again. Think about this case. Originally, we had this large system, and this system has almost a comparable length scale for x, y, and z direction. And in this case, it is just regarded as a bulk system. But now, instead of this bulk-like system, now we introduce really confined system. So in this case, although we are talking about the same band, but even inside the same band, we can find a certain discontinuity inside the EK diagram. So now we say that, oh, when we consider bulk system, there was no discontinuity. But now when we consider it, then it becomes discontinuous. Then we will call it as just a subband. So subband means internal substructure of a given band. So maybe I should repeat it again and again. But anyway, let me go to our specific example right now. So consider our three-dimensional box again. And we all know that eigen energy is given by just a sum of x-directional contribution and y-directional contribution and z-directional contribution. You understand? And when we introduce a system whose z-directional length scale is much, much smaller than x-directional length scale and y-directional length scale, then now it becomes obvious that since this number is large and this number is quite small, and when we say comparable values for L and M, for example, consider 1, 1, 1, what will be the dominant contributor to the E sub L, M, N? So you can easily understand only this one will contribute dominantly. And when we increase this 1, 1, 1 into 2, 1, 1 or 1, 2, 1 or 1, 1, 2, we can easily understand from this original value for e sub 1, 1, 1. This number or that number will not show much difference, so they will be quite close to e sub 1, 1, 1. However, when we consider the values corresponding to e sub 1, 1, 2, which has larger value for g-directional confinement, in this case, we can find that this number is too much different from e sub 1, 1, 1, so it becomes more difficult to consider them as just belonging in the same group. Depending on the size of confinement, this phenomenon can be quite severe. For example, think about this one. Now we have LZ equal to 5 nanometer. However, LX and LY goes to infinity, That is infinitely wide plane and very thin, really thin plate. In this case, contribution from this x-directional or y-directional confinement will be nearly negligible than the one from g-directional confinement. So, in this case, when we have a comparable number for LZ, let's say LX and LY and LZ are the same, in that case, maybe our energy for E sub 1, 1, 1 and 1, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 1. These will be more or less similar, depending, of course, depending on directional mass. But anyway, they will be quite similar to each other. So there will be no discontinuity. Everything is just quite close to our E sub 1, 1, 1. But if we have quite a small LZ, then now this one becomes especially distinct from this E 1, 1, 1. So they cannot be treated as a single band. It is much more beneficial or reasonable to treat these two values as discontinuous quantities. Okay, so now we can cover the next page. So change in n introduce big differences in E sub L M N. Up to now we have talked about this one. So therefore the energy levels corresponding to different n values can be categorized into different subbands. So previously we had L, M, N, which are on the same basis, but now we say that these two are regarded as more continuous one. This one is becoming more discontinuous one in love sense. So think about this case. Here I have made a visualization. If I have to draw the original bulk structure's isosurface, then I would like this. So L, M, and N. So here we can define certain point corresponding to our L value and M value and N value. Then we can define energy values E sub L, M, N, and I will draw a isosurface. For example, if I draw the isosurface for our band structure, which have different directional masses, then maybe we will have an ellipsoid, which is the distorted sphere. So along certain axis, this is just becomes longer, and for another surface or another axis, this one becomes shorter. So we will have a certain ellipsoidal structure for our original bulk structure. But please don't be confused with this original three-dimensional EK relation and the one drawn here. This one, although looks similar, but here we have only L and M. Then where is N? So we will just neglect N and just draw it in L and M surface plane. And where is then N information? And here we have five different sheets of planes. So here we have three different sheets of energy levels, and these five different graphs are corresponding to n equal to 1 and n equal to 2, 3, 4, and 5. So then let me say here, can you see it clearly? The red dot? This red dot is corresponding to our 1,1,1 component, because this is n equal 1 curve and our L value and M value are 1. So think about this starting point and let's increase L only or M only and N only. What will happen? So here when we increase L values, then we just arrive here. Not that much different from our previous energy. Or if we increase M value, then we will go to this one. But when we increase our N values, what we will have is much larger difference than this difference or that difference. This one becomes more significant when we consider this point. So this point is corresponding to 1,1,4. And let's just repeat the same discussion again. Now we increase the L value, then it becomes just a small deviation. And when we increase M value, also that introduces only small deviation. So then what will be the next? If we increase N value, then it suddenly jumps into this much larger value. So it is difficult to consider this point as just a connected one to the original one. So it becomes more and more reasonable to think about just the substructure of the bulk band. So I hope that is helpful for you to understand the concept of subband. So this is the concept of a subband, and this code is just for visualization. So I will just skip it. So okay, for a given subband with N, now we think that since N is given, the wave function along this G direction is given by, for example, this quantum number N. And how about the motion along X direction or Y direction? In this case, we neglect the quantum confinement effect. So no quantum confinement along other directions. Then we will expand the size Lx and Ly to infinity and allow just the free motion of our electrons. So typical trick to allow the free motion along that direction is periodic boundary condition along X direction and Z direction. Then now here and there we have the length scale of Lx, and now we say psi of 0 and yg equal to psi of Lx, yg. So we have applied periodic boundary condition along x direction. Also, same holds for y direction. Please note that previously in lecture 10, we have applied that the wave function at 0, yg should vanish. Also, psi at Lx, yg should vanish. For infinite potential wave problem, we have applied these boundary condition. But now, instead of this vanishing boundary condition at boundaries, now we introduce just periodic boundary condition. So now you can easily understand we can decompose our three-dimensional Schrödinger equation into three different sub-problems along each direction. And let's consider y direction again. Our directional Schrödinger equation just looks like this. And previously, we had applied the vanishing boundary conditions for these two ends, like y equal to 0 and y equal to ly. In order to satisfy that vanishing boundary condition, we had to introduce something like a sine function, which is proportional to y, and that is pi over ly, and its multiple, positive integer multiple, was introduced to the basis function for our solution. But now we have more relaxed one, like a periodic boundary condition, so we don't have to have vanishing wave function at y equal to 0 or y equal to L sub y. So instead of this sine function, which is strictly valid for the vanishing boundary condition, we will use this plane wave as a solution for this system. Now you understand the difference between infinite potential wave problem and this periodic boundary condition. And here, of course, since we have periodicity still, we have to have a certain boundary values. For example, let's just insert y equal to 0. Then we will have a y and exponential 0. Exponential 0 gives us just a number, a sub y, and just number 1. And how about this? Y equal to ly. In this case, we will have ay multiplied by exponential iky ly. Our boundary condition, periodic boundary condition, just says that these two values should be the same. So we can certainly say exponential e to the iky ly should be 1. Oh. So now we understand this one, the ky multiplied by ly should be a integer multiple of 2 pi. So this is integer multiple of 2 pi will be the enough condition for having e to the I ky k ly equal to 1. So please note that in this case, this integer can be any integer, not only positive 1, but 0 and negative 1s are allowed. So now our condition for ky multiplied by ly ly now becomes 2 pi multiplied by an integer which can be negative and positive. So this one becomes our solution. If we adopt this type of this boundary condition, then again ky value is quantized. And for every point corresponding to ky, we have an interval of 2 pi over ly. This is the interval inside the ky axis to have certain state. So if we increase ky by amount of 2 pi over ly, then we will find a new ky point, and that is corresponding to a new state. If we have to count the number of states for our ky values corresponding to m, then it can be transformed as just dky divided by 2 pi over ly. Let me just do it once again. Let's say I wanted to make a sum over m equal to 1 to infinity. Then it means that I will just add m equal 1 case. This is the number 1 for m equal 1 case, m equal 2 case, and m equal infinity case. So we just make a summation. But how about this? Instead of a summation, if we just make it as an integral over ky, then from certain range here and there, this m equal to 1 will be assigned. And also for m equal to, we will make another assignment. And please note that m equal 1 is corresponding to ky. If this is the ky axis, then in ky axis, m equal 1 is corresponding to 2 pi over ly. And m equal 2 is corresponding to 2 pi over ly multiplied by number 2. So the control volume over the range of our integration now becomes just here. This length will be 2 pi over ly, and also along this direction 2 pi over ly. So let's just integrate number 1. So number 1 and number 1. And in this case, we will just have the number 1. However, when we make dky number 1 from, for example, just pi over ly and 3 pi over ly, the range of integration, this range, then what will happen? We will have, unfortunately, just 2 pi over ly. So although our aim is to just transform or approximate our original summation with the integration, but just mere conversion to the integration over ky introduce a certain leading coefficient which is not of our intention. So in order to compensate it, then what we have to do is just multiply inverse of it. So we just introduce just inverse of 2 pi over ly. Then now what will happen? In this case, this operation will give us just number 1. So by using this technique, we can say this summation can be transformed or approximate with this integration. So I think that you have already studied this technique when you study the semiconductor material and devices in your undergrad school ages. But if you are not familiar with this concept, please try to understand this concept now. Then let's go to the next slide. Now we'll revisit. Now we'll revisit the total number problem. Previously we have calculated, yes, we all understand, for three-dimensional infinite well problem. But now we have changed the boundary condition for x direction and y direction. So how about this case? In this case, now our range for L value and M value is no longer start from number 1. L and M now start from minus infinity and goes to positive infinity, minus infinity, positive infinity. So we have slightly different meaning for L and M. And summation is just given as here. So here we have a triple summation, and now we believe that this one, the N summation, is corresponding to the summation over different subend. So we will just keep it the outermost one, and now the all other summation becomes inner calculation in of a given subend. This is for a single subend calculation, and after that we can just introduce the summation over all subends available. The summation of a Fermi Dirac function is required, and after that, as we have discussed in the previous slide, this summation can be easily converted into this integral, and also this M summation can be converted into KY summation. So here we have a leading coefficient, and they can be just put here, and now we have this simple integral. Okay, so here please note that we have to perform the integration over ky and kx two-dimensional k-space. So two-dimensional k-space calculation is needed. And okay, this is a really big deal. Also, we can try to numerical integration. Numerical integration is possible. Integration is already possible because we have made this two-dimensional integration. However, if we have a simple cases where mxx and myy are equal, then we can make a further simplification. So how can you make a further simplification? Since mxx and myy, these are the same, so now we can say these two terms can be merged into just square of k. So just a distance from the origin and our two-dimensional k point, that is important. The angle dependency is now gone. So If we can neglect this angle dependence, then this two-dimensional integration can be expressed instead of this Cartesian one. Now we can introduce this polar coordinate one. And here we have angle-dependent integration. But this angle-dependent integration just becomes simple multiplication of a factor of 2pi. So this is just possible because our integrand has no dependencies on angle variable theta. So now, instead of a double integral, now we have just a single integral and we can calculate it. Okay, so in the lecture contents here, we have general cases like m, x, x, and m, y, y is not the same. So we'll think about it later, but for a while, just concentrate on the mxx equal to myy case, then we can have this simple expression. Okay. So up to now, our achievement is, originally we have to do double summation, but this double summation now becomes double integral. So also by using special property of our integrand, now one of them now becomes just a constant, and now we have arrived just integration over magnitude of our k variable. So that is the thing we have achieved up to now. And finally, we can convert it to energy integration. Instead of this dk, we can introduce the energy variable. Why don't you do that together with me? So here, k, actually we have kx square and ky square. So when we multiply half a square and 2mxx, then we can get kx square and ky square. This one becomes the energy contribution in xy plane. So this is simply given by half a square 2mxx and k square. If we have this form, now we can say the infinitesimal change of our energy will be just proportional to k times dk. So you can understand it quite easily. And here we can find k times dk. And fortunately, here we have k times dk. So this k times dk can be expressed as just mxx over half a square and dexy. So you can just look at this conversion here, convert to quantity, and the upper bound and lower bound is just kept as before, because the number k equal to 0 is corresponding to 0 of our xy directional energy, and infinite value of k is of course corresponding to the infinite value over our energy variable. Okay, so now we have convert our original summation, double summation, into single integration over energy axis. This transformation is particularly beneficial because our integrand Fermi-Dirac distribution is actually a function of energy, not a function of wave number k. Of course, already we have a single integral, and this single integral can be easily calculated by the numerical integration. Yeah, that is quite easy. But fortunately, this form really allows us the analytic solution. So why don't you just go to the analytic solution? Here, okay. Here we can find this form. This is related with our total number calculation. For a given subband per skin, we have this leading coefficient blah blah blah, oh, quite a lengthy coefficient, but anyway, oh, here we have also another leading coefficient, but point is the actual calculation we need to is just to integrate our Fermi-Dirac function with our energy. But point is, the integration is not like this. Mm-hmm. The integration should be something plus the contribution from g directional. So I think that this becomes the minimum energy of the nth subband. You know that even when we have zero contribution from x, y direction, but still we have a certain energy from quantum confinement. So this is the offset values to be inserted the Fermi-Dirac distribution. So we'll keep this in mind. Then let's go to the Fermi-Dirac distribution. So neglecting all of leading coefficient, then the essential operation now becomes just integrating our Fermi-Dirac function from 0 to infinity and with a certain offset. So what will happen? In the previous lecture 10.5, I have not discussed it, you know, in detail. So that's the reason why in the main lecture I'm just considering this point again. So here we have EY, and we have introduced the normalized quantity, the energy normalized by the summer energy. So now dExy, the capital one, becomes just kBT times the small one. So we have small one here and converted integration variable, and here we have certain numbers like this. I have just written explicitly our Fermi-Dirac distribution function. Mm-hmm. So then, now we have to define the Fermi-Dirac integral of order 0. Fermi-Dirac integral of order 0 just means that here we have Fermi-Dirac function, and order 0 means that here we have just x power 0, just number 1. So then let's define different Fermi-Dirac function. For example, half order have, then how can we write down? Then that will be just integration of Fermi Dirac function 1 plus exponential x minus eta. So now you can understand this eta just performs the role of normalized Fermi energy. If we have just number 1, then that is corresponding to the Fermi integral with order 0. However, if we are considering order half, then we have to have just square root of x. And if we have order 1 here, then how does it look like? Then in this case, we have number 1. That is quite understandable. So we can define so many different Fermi Dirac integral. For example, also another relevant one will be minus half. Oh, that occurs also sometimes. So we have minus half too. So anyway, we define the Fermi Dirac integral of order something as just to integrate our Fermi Dirac function with x power the order. That will give us Fermi Dirac integral of order something. This one can have an analytic solution, which is given by log of 1 plus exponential eta. Please note that once again, this eta plays a role of Fermi level. Okay, so therefore, now we can identify our integral shown here as just Fermi Dirac integral of order 0 with this number is corresponding to our eta function. So with this eta function, now we can write down this form, and since this is eta, our eventual result will be KBT. This is just coming from the variable transformation and log 1 plus exponential eta value. Okay, so now we have an analytic expression. Expression for our integration. So what was our goal? Our goal was to calculate the total number of electrons. So the total number of electrons can be obtained from just double summation over L value and M value, but we have converted it to so double integral, and by certain condition of mxx equal to myy, now we can eliminate the dependence on angle variable. So now we have made just one single integral. After that, for this special case, we can even find the analytic expression that is corresponding to log 1 plus exponential eta. So that is the procedure we have done up to now. So let me summary. Then if we have to calculate the number, total number of electrons inside this two-dimensional system, then because one-dimensional g-directional motion is prohibited, so now we have just a two-dimensional motion. So in this case, the number of electrons for a given subband, a single subband, is simply given by, here we have a lot of leading coefficient, and finally have log 1 plus exponential. This is corresponding to eta. So that is all for our solvent calculation. After that, since this is just for a single solvent and per spin, in order to calculate the total number of electrons, we have to make the summation over solvent and consider spin degeneracy number 2. So that is appearing here. So that is all for calculating the total number of electrons. So we can have analytic expression. There will be no integration at all. So you can do it by yourself. And here we have only one thing missing in today's lecture is, up to now we have discussed about the case where mxx, m, and myy are identical. However, think about this one. In silicon, we can think about three different valley types. For example, mxx, myy, mzz. Typically, we can find three pairs. The first pair has and the second pair has this one, and the last one having this one. Then my question is our assumption of having the same mass, effective mass along x direction and y direction, is it valid for all three types of valleys? How about this? You can easily understand. For this valley, yes, we certainly have the same mass for x direction and y direction. However, for other two valleys, unfortunately, our x-directional mass and y-directional mass are not the same. So it means that our previous discussion based upon the isotropic mass breaks down, so we cannot follow the same procedure. However, don't be worried too much. So we have a certain remedy for this situation. That is shown here. Even when we have different masses, by introducing internal coordinate transformation, so up to now we have worked with kx and ky as just integration variables, but instead of this original kx and ky, we have introduced kx prime and ky prime, which is just a slightly modified one, just multiplied with a certain coefficient. With this coefficient, what we can do effectively is, you know that the isotropies of our band looks like an ellipsoid. So here you can see that we have three different masses. Here we have three different valleys, and they have, along a certain direction, they have heavy masses, and for other two directions they have light masses. So in this case, the isotropies just looks like an ellipsoid. So, by applying this transformation, coordinate transformation, the isotropies inside the transformed space just looks like a sphere instead of ellipsoid. So that is the goal of this internal transformation. So by applying this internal transformation, what we get eventually is the same formulation can be applied to the case with different mxx and different myy values. Even in this case, when they are not the same, we can introduce a new effective mass, m sub d, which is given by square root of mxx and myy. With this number, we can just use the same expression as before. As before what? Before means that the isotropic mass case. That is really good news for analytic expression. So then now let's go to the here we have a MATLAB example. And this MATLAB example, here you can see that we have no integration, and this one is just corresponding to summation over n. That's it. So each for each subn, we can calculate the number of electrons belonging to each subn, and by summing them all, we can calculate the total number. But please note that all of this calculation is based upon the Fermi level equal to 0 electron volt. That was our basic assumption. And now you have really simple homework. And the homework is just to change your Fermi level. Instead of Fermi level of 0 electron volt, please change it from minus 0.3 electron volt to positive 0.1 electron volt. Then you can calculate the total number, and this total number will be just a number. It has no unit, but in order to calculate your total number, anyhow you have to define this Lx and Ly value and just to evaluate your total number divided by your Lx and Ly. Then you will get the areal density, the number per square centimeter. Please report your integrated electron density, which is in per square centimeter, as a function of Fermi energy. Then how can you get this number? So since this expression, or this expression, is all based upon the Fermi level equal to 0, so you have to consider it here. So Fermi, please consider your Fermi level here, then you will get the result. That will be quite quick, and if you know the way, that will just change of just one line. I think that this homework will be particularly easy and simple, and the reason why I give you this simple one is for you to have a certain time to catch up our lecture contents up to now. If you have not done homework number 10, please have your time to catch up our lecture progress. Number 10 is particularly important. Okay, so then see you this Wednesday. Bye.